Good evening. For all those who have watched me conduct these kind of sessions, it's mainly been in the zone of entertainment. Very rarely have I done something on this kind of a prestigious and prolific platform. Something that has been political and industrial and corporate is new to me and my arena. So I'd like all those who have watched Coffee with Karan to forget the frivolousness attached to that show and really focus on more in-depth subjects that we will possibly address. And for those who are disappointed with what I just said, there will always be something that will come up. We have members of the fraternity with us on this panel. Well, so I'm going to introduce this panel. It's actually was considered the young panel. I don't know why I'm moderating it. At 45, it's a bit embarrassing for me to address many.
You have company.
No, not at all. Even you're younger than me. I checked your date of birth. I'm completely terribly depressed that 45, I have to do a young panel of conversation. But it's none the same, it's really exciting. I'm going to introduce the lady first, Alia Bhatt, actor well, she started her career with me when she was all of 17, and when the film released, she was all of 18, and it's been 6 years into the movies with over 10 releases, many successes, and many great performances in her kitty. She truly is the leading voice and the leading actor of the movie fraternity in India. Kavin Mittal, I mean, what do I say about him? At 30 to be listed with this kind of equity is phenomenal. 1.4 billion is what the estimated worth is, what I read last, Kavin, if I'm wrong about that. Over 100 million subscribers. That to us is like the 100 crore club with the movie, so it's a big achievement. To be 30 and so phenomenally successful is always admirable, Kavin Mittal. And of course, I've been allowed to call this very suave gentleman Ram, KD Rama Rao. Can I call you Ram already? Am I allowed?
You should call me Ram. I insist you're older than me. So.
But Minister of IT, Municipal Administration and Urban Development, Industries and Commerce, Public Enterprises, Sugar, Mines and Geology, and Non-Resident Indian Affairs of Telangana. My God, when do you sleep?
I try.
All right. Okay. So this is going to be a lot of fun. I think we're going to discuss where we are in terms of development, be it political, social, economic, and also individually, all three of them, the challenges they face to be achievers at such a young stage. Ali, I'm going to start with you. Always the ladies first. You come from a film family and have achieved everything at such a young age. Today, at 24, you know, is it too good too soon as a phenomena, you think?
Firstly, good evening, everyone. I know my father will be very proud of me because I'm in a very intelligent room and in a very intelligent space and an intelligent hotel for today. But I have to say that whenever people ask me about my achievements, Karan, about how, you know, you're doing so well, how do you feel, you're doing this, you're doing that, to me, I'm just doing. I have no idea of how well I'm doing and what that means for me and whether this is too good too soon or whether I'm going to burn out. I think that if I sit back and assess every step I take, then I'm going to be taking myself way too seriously. All I want to do is give a lot of heart into all my performances, into every character that I play. And I want to be remembered for the movies that I'm a part of and the characters that I play, because that's the kind of impact movies had on me as a child. So I want to be giving, I want to be that impact on the younger generation and the older generation and everybody. So yeah, I never look at myself as a third person. I'm just going with the flow, as they say.
And Kavin, do you feel the same? Do you feel the same, or did you like feel like you have acquired ambition, you know, with all your achievements? Do you think things fell into place and you're going to go with the flow, or you created this flow for yourself very, very organically?
I think that's a great question. I think, just to echo what Alia was saying, if you find your passion, you jump straight into it.
Right.
And if you happen to be good at it, you get success. And if you have a very open-minded attitude towards life and also view failure as learnings as you move forward, especially at such a young age, I think the universe will find a place for you and put you in the right place. And I think that quest to have an impact and a mission-driven attitude in life, I think, is very, very important, because ambition is good, but ambition can sometimes be a little selfish.
Right.
And I think that it's important to make that distinction very early on if you can.
Right. Well said. I think that I endorse that completely. I come from that ethos. Ram, To be such an eminently successful politician at such a young age, to take on the daunting task of everything that you have, you know, from the creation of a state to everything that you've achieved, every honor and accolade that has come your way, how does this pressure get to you, if at all?
Well, firstly, before I talk about it, I think Alia said her dad is going to be very proud of her for being at the WEF. I think my daughter is going to be immensely proud of me today. She's a huge Alia Bhatt fan, 8 years old. So I think just the fact that I'm sitting right next to Alia Bhatt, I think she's going to look up to me quite a bit now. Thank you. Now, talking about pressure or talking about, I think, work-life balance, talking about success, I think there are four fields in India which are quite out in the open in the sense of being there in the media every single day without fail. You have politicians. You have movie stars, you have sportsmen, and you have businessmen. These are the four guys who make it to the news every single day. Yes, on good days you receive bouquets, and bad days you receive brickbats. But I think the fact of the matter is, we are the privileged ones, so to speak, today in a country like ours. So yes, in fact, expectation, the burden of expectation, especially because I come from the youngest state in India.
Right.
And this is a state that was created after a protracted struggle with Hyderabad as the capital. And the burden of expectation is, of course, there. And I'm second-gen politician. My father's now the chief minister of Telangana, and he's the man who led the fight for Telangana. So the burden of expectation is, of course, there. But end of the day, one has to remember that all you can do is, like Alia said, do your best. Leave the rest of the people to judge, to do whatever they want, because ultimately they're the ones who decide either the fate of the movie or the fate of a politician.
That's true. And do comparisons get to you all the time? Like, you know, when you, which I'm going to get to Alia and to Kavin as well, the constant comparison to something else, you know, which is what the media sometimes tends to do, you know, to pit you against someone at that moment who may have been more successful or may have emerged at that moment. How do you react to that and how do you deal with it?
Well, a lot of times you feel like you're living under a shadow, especially because you're a second-gen politician or a movie star or whatever, because you have a certain billing to live up to. But end of the day, I think what matters is your name tag or your surname only serves as an entry pass. Beyond that, I think it's you. It's all you. Alia Bhatt could be Mahesh Bhatt's daughter, but I think once she's on screen, she'll be rated for her performance in Urta Punjab or whatever movie she does.
Right.
Because I think what matters end of the day is people's acceptance. In a democracy, I think, in the world's largest democracy, as long as you're accepted, because people always, you know, are very brutal. If they don't like a Karan Johar movie, they'll pan it. They don't care if it's made by Karan Johar or, you know, whoever.
Yeah, well, trust me, I know that.
I think I do too. So, point I'm trying to make is, I think, end of the day, these name tags, these build-ups, these expectations only serve you to a certain extent, and beyond that, it's all you.
Well, that's true. Kavin, you've gone on record to say that, you know, you've had an unique unfair advantage, quote-unquote. Though I think you would say that you would be a product of reverse nepotism, because you don't exactly do what your father does. You created an entire space for yourself with Hike Messenger. Was that conscious?
That statement?
No, just the eventuality of it.
When I say I have a unique unfair advantage, I'm a big believer that everybody has something in their life that they have unique to themselves.
Right.
And I think that having access to a person like my own father has helped tremendously because of the empire that he's built. And the amount of learnings you can get through that at a very early age, just having that exposure becomes a unique unfair advantage.
Right.
And then it's up to you on how you harness that and deploy that. And I happen to be also in the field of business, so a lot of those learnings do come to sort of fruition in a big way. I think that's the angle from which I'd look at it.
That's great. And when it comes to comparisons, do you feel like with Hike Messenger that is doing so phenomenally well, you know, and there are other platforms that constantly get compared, which is what we were speaking about with Ram as well, like say WhatsApp and everything else. Do you feel like you sometimes get bogged down with the comparison, or do you feel emerging from it and emerging victorious isn't high in itself?
Yeah, I think from a very early age, like, you know, the panelists over here, I've had spotlight on me.
Right.
From very early sort of time. And when you're building a business, in the early part of the business, it's important not to have that spotlight. It gives you time to figure out the path that you want to go chase after. But I think there was one thumb rule that I followed from very early on, which is, at the end of the day, if there are 24 hours in a day, you're sleeping for probably 7-8 hours, and you have 16 waking hours, I think your life is directly proportional to where you deploy those 16 hours. Not only physically, but also mentally.
Right.
So you can choose, you have a choice.
Right.
I think then you can make that choice to deploy your time in a way that's very constructive. So you can worry about the comparisons, you can worry about what people think, but I think if you deploy that time effectively on solving big problems, the results will speak for itself. I think that's the approach.
Instead of getting bogged down by constant comparison.
Sure, absolutely. Sure.
And Alia, in your field, there's always, I mean, I think that sometimes, you know, the entertainment media doesn't make it easy, you know, for you to kind of, you know, go beyond yourself. Because at every, what we call media policing on a daily basis, from the time you exit your home to the time you go back, and I'm not talking about the very famous airport looks or gym looks that are always talked about, but I'm talking about even performance comparisons, star statuses, you know, constantly like pitting one Friday against the other about how you're doing at the movies and how you're not. At your age, I always wonder sometimes, you know, that how do you handle it? And are you taking it head on at all? Does it bother you, affect you, get to you? And do you have vulnerable moments?
So I think definitely initially I was very vulnerable, and I was also very hungry to prove and make a point. And I want to say with age, but I don't think I should say that since I'm 24. But maybe with experience, and just as you said, I've been working since I'm 17. But in the last 2 years, there just came a bit of a realization to me, and that is the only constant in life is change. So today, I may be getting a lot of love, tomorrow I won't, maybe. Today, I may be getting a lot of hate, tomorrow I won't, maybe. So some things are, you know, are like some days you may wake up and say that, okay, you know, I wish I'm being better at this, so I have a better, you know, I had better diction, I had better this. I can always talk about what I don't have and what I'm, you know, what I can do better. But instead of whining about how they're comparing me to people, I can just better it.
Right.
And I can just try to be the better version of myself.
In a sense, Ram, this cyclical feeling of getting intense love and then sometimes not, or is a big part of the political domain as well. Like, you know, you suddenly go through phases of intense love that comes your way, you know, applause for something you might have created or done, and then there's criticism the very next day, perhaps the next month. This constant cyclical feeling, this seasonal love and hate, where is that zone that you strike a balance?
Well, love-hate relationship with, you know, whoever it is, your customers, your people, is something that is, I think, constant across different domains. In fact, I'm the Minister for Industry and Commerce, Information Technology, and Municipal Administration. I've been doing okay on industry and IT, but one complaint I do have with myself, in fact, is about the municipal administration aspect. The other day, Hyderabad was under a deluge, like how Bombay was, in fact, some time back. Even I was stuck in July 2006, even I was stuck in Bombay 24 hours. So the kind of feedback you get on that particular day from people, you're tweeting about how well you're doing in India Economic Summit, and then somebody tweets you back saying, dude, get the Hyderabad roads right. So yes, I do know what you're saying, the seasonality of people's affections. And I think it's a reflection of their mindset. You can't fault it, because it entirely depends on that particular day, that given movement, what they've been feeling, what they've been going through, and that kind of reflects in how it gets manifested in their feedback to you, either in the form of anger or sometimes in the form of love, sometimes in the form of, you know, some other form as well, you know.
Yeah, well, trolling is what you just referred to, is
absolutely
what I think you, me and Alia go through. And trolling for you would be consumer feedback, Kavin, in terms of, like, do you handle that?
No, I think his father trolls him. I know his father very well. I think he kind of trolls him sometimes. Once
you get trolled by your father at all, Kavin?
No, not at all.
So with you, it's consumer feedback, because, you know, consumers, as we know, are kings and, you know, of their own domain, but always very, very relentless in their feedback. You know, there's always something that is coming your way, something, a feature that may not have worked, and something that they feel you should up your game with. How much do you listen to them? It's like, and I can say that for ourselves as well, with you, the people that surround you, you know, the audience that you cater to, and the consumers you cater to. How much is it, where is that you strike that zone of balance between listening to them and doing your own, following your own instinct?
I think that's a great point. I think consumers are relentless.
Yeah.
They just want the best and they don't care where it comes from.
Right.
And I think that's good, because then if you understand that really well, you can hold yourself to that standard.
Right.
And I think what's very fascinating about the internet space is that everything is lines of code. So the rate at which you can evolve and harness this feedback is very, very fast. So I built the company in a way where we are very consumer-facing, and that customer request, when they come through, no matter how good or bad, there is some pain point in there.
Right.
And you also have to build an environment where people embrace this versus shunning it away. Many a times when you build something, you're very attached to it. And you don't want to hear bad feedback. But constructive feedback from consumers is the only way to go forward because that's the market you're serving. And I think that applies to, I think, everything. Politics right. And the movie industry too.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, you know, veering the conversation from everything that's personal to everything that's now national-based, the narrative of India is what everyone's talking about. That's what pretty much what our sessions have been about today. So much optimism, some skepticism, sometimes criticism, but eventually there is a certain zone of positivity that we all like to operate within. Ram, you're most eligible to answer this question. If I had to ask you about the Indian story, the Indian narrative, our development socially, politically, and economically, what do you think would be your mainstay in terms of like where we are at today?
Well, I think India is an amazing story unfolding at this point in time. In fact, we are at a point of inflection, if you ask me, because India has always been a story that is... I've lived in the United States for about 8 years after my education. I've worked there. And always, whenever the topic of India came up, India was always a subject that was discussed with a lot of optimism, hope, but also very cautiously, you know. It's a very difficult country to do business in, and it is always, you know, with a caveat, which comes in right after they say, you know, it's a very good country to do business in. But at this point in time, I think, at one point of time, if you go back, say, 15 years or 20 years behind, and if you look at it, India's population was considered its bane. But now, it has become its strength. Today, if you look at India, one of the biggest strengths of India today is our human resource, our workforce, our think force. Because more than 50% of India's population today is less than the age of 27.
Right.
More than 65% of India's population today is less than the age of 35. That gives us the largest think force on the planet. And in a knowledge economy, you can't ask for more. So as the world is aging, India is getting younger. I think we have very progressive governments which are really accelerating the kind of... growth story that needs to unfold, because we can't talk about leapfrogging anymore. We have to talk about pole vaulting, and we have to really start thinking what US has done in 25, 30 years, how we can do it in the next 5 to 10 years. So we have to set a very, very ambitious and an aggressive agenda. We need more capital, and India is being looked at as a story, as an investment, in fact, from a business perspective, as an investment which is going to pay off big time.
Right.
So I think as long as we live up to that billing, as long as we live up to the positive hope and image that our prime minister is creating outside of India as well, I think we're going to do really well in the next one decade.
Wonderful. Demographically, Kavin, we're considered one of the youngest nations. It's just that, you know, many, many aging economies will also agree and say that, you know, we're demographically really, truly young, and that really makes possibilities endless. Does that help you in your enterprise, just the fact that we're such an emerging young economy?
Oh, absolutely. I think the young people are, just generally speaking, the fresher, they're more dynamic, they're faster to adopt new things. So if you look at hike today, we're very, very dominant between the age of 15 and 25. So having a very large youth population has done wonders for hike, because that's where we're very, very strong.
Right.
And I think that, you know, I echo the hope that we have for the country. The potential is massive. Especially because we have a young population, and when you're younger, you tend to have less attachment. So right. You can take more risks. And I think that's a very big deal. I think because a lot of big breakthroughs come from big risks.
Right.
But there are also causes for concern. I think India as a society has to be, has to build a more psychologically safe environment to take those risks.
Right.
For example, failure is looked at not in the best way still in most pockets of this country. And I think that while there is a lot of hope, there's also some real issues that have to be addressed at the ground level reality when we talk about the youth and what they can do too. Yeah.
Detachment and taking risks, Alia. Kavin says that about the young, and I totally agree with that. I do feel that there's a sense of strong detachment. I say that in a good way, because most spiritual teachings teach you the art of detachment. How detached are you from trappings that surround you? And does risks come into that play because you're so detached?
I totally agree with Kavin, because that's what I meant earlier by saying that change is the only constant. If I get so attached to the kind of films that people are liking, say if somebody, people like Highway and they liked Urta Punjab, that means I only do those kind of films. I don't do any kind of cinema, because obviously they like it, you know, when they like it when I'm getting, when I'm in tough situations or when I'm looking not like myself or I'm just like really having a really hard time.
You have done a lot series of dysfunctional work.
I have.
And not that your work is dysfunctional, characters have
been. But then that wouldn't make me probably take a risk and do Badrinath Ki Dulhania, which is till date my highest grossing film. Yeah. So definitely I'm super detached from my work and I don't want to get too attached to even the person that I am today. When people come up to me and say, you know, you're so inspiring and all of those things and what I do for other people, I feel really happy, I feel grateful. I take a moment to remember that, okay, this is something that, this is what you really work for to make an impact. But then that instantly I just like snap out of it and I said, I just tell myself that this is not going to be there tomorrow.
And as a young Indian woman, Alia, is there a sense of responsibility you have to your country, to other women who are inspired by you, to younger girls, you know, who feel like, you know, you are their role model? How much of that ethos really creeps into your thoughts when you take on a film or, you know, are on a public platform? How much of that are you conscious of?
So when I take on a film, I don't keep the audience in mind. And I don't think I should as well, because then that would make my decisions very calculated and very boring. I go with my gut and I go with my heart. So that's the way I choose my films. But when I'm on a public platform, I mean, I have made mistakes and all in the past in public platforms.
Really, when? When was that?
Well, that was a while ago. In fact, Ram walked it. We were in the room. I have to share this with you. And it's always very embarrassing for Alia.
No, I don't have to
share it. But Ram just watched her episode of Coffee with Karan that made Alia Bhatt quite famous, actually, when she had a little bit of a blip there. Ram, that was very, very wonderful that you actually did your research.
What was the blip? I'm not aware.
We're not going to go
you
there.
You are. As I was saying, I actually take key from that, and I like to promote the idea of people can make mistakes. That is okay. And as a celebrity, I'm still a human being and I don't have the answer to everything. I don't know. Like right now, I'm like looking at you like, and I'm looking like,
what?
I know nothing. I know what I do and I really am not embarrassed of that, because if I don't say I don't know, how am I going to know? Like if I don't ask the questions, how am I going to get the answers? So, yeah, I don't know. Why am I making this point? What were we talking about?
It's okay. Yeah. It's fine.
You so basically, yes, I'm detached and I take risks. And yes, I find it very important to be a responsible public speaker. And for me, many women, many actresses, many, public figures have been inspiring as women to me. Like whether it's Deepika coming out and talking about her depression, whether it's Kajol, who's always made such interesting film choices. I've always, you know, looked up at women and taken inspiration from them. So I hope to also be that way for some younger girls someday.
But Karan, you have to give it to the girl, because she actually had it in herself after, making a small mistake. She actually had it in herself to laugh at herself. I think
she did.
That really deserves a round of applause.
She honestly did, because Alia went on, in fact, you should have a look at it. She went for All India with AIB. And
it's called Genius of the Year.
I was going to say what the whole form of AIB is, and I thought that would be politically incorrect. But AIB did this whole, this whole take on how Alia made that big blip. And it was really sporting of her, actually, to go ahead and do that. You know, not very many people take that kind of situation
Absolutely.
On their chin. And so, yes, bravo. Well done. if you had to Ram, when you have someone like Alia, not because she's a movie actor, not because but she represents the youth in so many ways, and if you were to ask her a question about just way of thinking, is there a question that you have that could be relevant to just the people that surround you? What would that question be?
To Alia Bhatt?
Yes. Not to her specifically, just someone who represents the youth in the way that she does.
Well, absolutely. I think... I have two young children.
All right.
I have a son who's 12 and I have a daughter who's 8. And what's with the fascination of these new age gadgets? You know, they're really hike messengers and, you know, all the movies and iPads. These are all kind of bringing in. I thought technology was all about simplifying our lives. You know, it's complicating it. So what's with that? That's the question I want to ask.
This question is definitely for
the next generation, the younger generation.
Firstly, I have to say that I totally agree with you.
Okay.
Because I'm probably the most... to say this correctly, technologically challenged person in this room. And I also believe that today, whether it's the Facebook or Twitter, I think it's the reason it brought us together, it's the same reason why it's kind of tearing us apart with the trolls and the hatred and all of that. So I actually am seeing today a very negative side to social media than I was probably when I started using it initially. I'm not talking about Hike Messenger. Hike Messenger rocks, guys. You should all have it on your phone. But
it's an endorsement.
Yeah, and that's for free. It's done.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm not the most technologically like savvy person. I'm pretty basic.
No, I think what Ram meant is like, you know, the constant time spent on social media. You know, it used to be conversations, it used to be analysis, it used to be discussions. Now it's all about like opinions that you're putting down, not like having those one-on-one conversations anymore. Somewhere I think emotions have taken a beating. Romance definitely has. It's just been replaced by everything that, you know, social media operates within. I think that was where he was going with his
yeah, question. But I'm also like, okay, I'm on my phone and all on Instagram and all. I'm quite addicted to that, but I make it a point when I'm on set and I'm working, I don't look at my phone. I only check it when I'm done from work, and if I'm spending time with my friends, like we have a rule, we put all the phones together in one circle and say, okay, nobody touch your phone. So I mean, I'm doing my bit. Are you?
Alia, your dad called. He complained that you're not calling him back enough. So kidding.
Kavin, I mean, it's this kind of generation that also is your audience base, so to say. And there is an irony in your demeanor where when I read that, you know, you're Zen in a certain way, you know, yep. You follow the philosophies of Buddhism. And then there is the craziness of social media. You know, they're two different opposite poles of thought processes. And you actually are creating one of a platform that actually contributes to the frenziness. And then at the other end, you're also all within. That kind of dichotomy is interesting and exciting as well, I think.
It is, and I think we keep talking about how, I think the best work is done when you're the most objective about it, and the only way to be objective about your work is to be completely detached from it.
Right.
So I feel like, at least that's my approach to building sort of my company. So it actually helps, it complements in what I do. So at Hike, what we're really good at doing is problem solving.
Right.
So you throw us, you know, a problem and anything, we can go solve it. And I think that happens because we have a very objective mindset on problem solving. And I think that helps. But to add to the conversation we're having right now, I think time will tell where this goes. It is worrying, but which technology in the history of the world has not had some side effects?
Right.
We just got to figure out how to cope with it, because at the end of the day, this is new. I don't think human beings were built to stare at a phone for 4 hours a day, but we'll evolve and we'll have to figure out what that looks like 6, 7, 10 years from now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's true. I mean, there is a criticism that says it plagues, you know, the way we live and the way, as opposed to the way we used to. And then there are, of course, the advantages that come with the territory.
But I'm sorry to cut you, but I guess those who complain about technology or this or social media, I just have to say that either way, an excess of anything is not good for you. So it basically depends on you, how you monitor yourself, how much you go overboard. So that's it. It all comes from within eventually. So you can't really point fingers at anyone.
Right. Ram, when we talk about the way forward, just for you personally, what is the next 10 years like going to be for you? Do you have any kind of a game plan?
Next 10 years, you know, the cliched answer would be I live one day at a time, but you know what, I do see myself still being in public life. I don't know, it all depends on people, I guess. If they still like me, I'll continue to be their representative. If they don't like me, I'll probably go and play golf, I don't know. The fact of the matter is, it's good to have plans, it's good to have short, medium, and long-term goals and plans, but end of the day, I think you'd rather be better off keeping them to yourself. You know, if I tell you here now on this podium that I want to be so-and-so by so-and-so date, and if it doesn't, and there's press here, by the way, and if it doesn't shape up that way, then you're going to look
silly. It'll be thrown right back at you.
So all I'm going to say is we should continue to do our good work, as Alia said and as Kavin said. We should just follow our heart, do our thing. Just wait for things to unfold, I guess.
And Kavin, do you have, like, apart from everything you've achieved at such a young age, is there a game plan for things that have yet to come from your enterprise? And pun intended there.
You know, when I founded the company, there was this picture that you always have in your mind of if all goes well, where you'd like to be. And India is a unique country in that we have 1 billion people coming online for the first time in their lives on a mobile device, onto the internet. That's not happened anywhere else,
right.
Which means that it's very, very different. And the big question that we were trying to solve was how would they come online? If you look at the country today, we have 1.3, 1.4 billion people. About 650 to 700 million unique mobile phone users.
Right.
There are still 500 million people that don't have phones. Out of 700 million people, you have 350 million feature phone users and 350 million smartphone users, out of which you have about 200 million real internet users. You know, in we say 1.3 billion people, but to harness that potential, I believe you need 1.3 billion people online.
Right.
So our mission has always been, how do we make it very simple and easy for a billion people to come online? And we believe messaging is a simple, easy, cheap way to come online for the mass market. And so if we can contribute towards that, even 5-10%, I think we'll be in a great place. And I think it's very important to remind ourselves why we do what we do. And I think at the core, it's all about having a positive impact on the world around you. If you can do that, at least I'll be a happy person. I think that's measured by the people that are sort of using your service and the impact that you're having on. So, you know, 5 years from now, we'd love to be in that place.
Alia, with so much talk about like the international domain and actors moving, you know, going beyond our boundaries, working out of the country, you know, making a place for them, and then there's so much talk about globalization, and there's a synergy of what I'm going to ask you. Is there an aspiration to go beyond your national audience for you?
I mean, I have aspirations to be the most loved actor in the universe, if that's possible. So definitely I would like to go, even if they send me to the moon, I would. But as of now, honestly, my main focus is to, and not only as myself as an actor, but to just make sure that the Indian film industry is thriving, like should thrive right now in the next 5 years, 10 years, because what's really bothering me right now is the fact that people aren't going to the theaters as much. But it's also a very interesting time for Indian movies. Because right now, truly, content is king. So the focus for us as an industry is to put out the best content right now, and so that the people just come to the theaters and, you know, they don't watch movies on their phones and pirated versions and all of that. So that's my main focus as a part of the Indian film industry.
And before we open the questions to the house, we did this exercise in the morning, and I'd love to repeat it with the three of you. Is that one word that comes to your mind when we think of the country we're at today?
India?
Yeah. The one word, and you could explain why.
One word, India. I think hope. Hope. I have a lot of hope for this country. I do believe that our potential is just being, we are, like I said, you know, we're at the point of inflection. So I just have the belief and hope that this is going to be one of the greatest nations ever. And we're at that point where we have all the ingredients ready, and we're just about to take off.
Hope. Hope. Right. Kavin.
The one that comes to top of mind is bold. I think this country is bold.
Okay.
I think the leadership at the front is bold.
Okay.
I think
that's the word. Yeah. All right. Alia.
It's one of my favorite words, fire. I feel like we have the ability to keep burning and to really, really spread the light.
Lovely. Well, we have hope, fire, and bold as the word for the state where we're at, the condition we're at. Ladies and gentlemen, Ram, Alia, and Kavin are now open to all of you. Could you please, if you have questions, state where who you are, publication you are from perhaps, and what your question is. Yes, ma'am. We're going to circulate the mic.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sugandha Munshi, and I'm a global shaper with World Economic Forum. And I work in the state of Bihar. I work with women farmers. So my question to the panel is that the present country, which you all have defined, is wonderful word, bold, fire, and hope. How do you think at the grassroots of the India, all the efforts you guys are making in different industry, is going to contribute more in coming decades?
Ram, you want to take that?
Yeah. The huge divide in India. I'm glad you're working in Bihar, and I'm glad you're trying to bring about the difference. In fact, one of the things I wanted to touch upon, and I keep saying this every so often whenever I meet an inward-looking investor into India. A lot of times, you know, a common mistake people make when they're looking to invest in India is, and when they're looking to toward India, in fact, is that they judge India through the prism of a World Bank report or a consultant report. And they make this oversimplified comparison between India and China. I keep telling a lot of these people, and I'm going to say the same thing to you now. China is a country. India is not. For all practical purposes, we are United States of India. Mm. India is a very heterogeneous country. Everything changes every 150 kilometers. The language, the cuisine, the culture, the habits, the literacy levels, the poverty levels, everything is so vastly different every 150 kilometers. You're absolutely right. Whatever this trickle-down effect that governments are trying to achieve in terms of good policies, in terms of good initiatives, unless it goes all the way right down to the grassroots, things are not going to change that quick. But India does not have an option. Like I was saying, we cannot wait for the next 25 years to become another China or become another emerged nation, a second world or the first world nation. We do not have an option but to leverage technology. We do not have an option but to leverage human resources. We also have to learn from the experience of others, other countries that have done very well in the last 15, 20, or 30 years. And we do not have the luxury of leapfrogging. We have to pole vault. We really have to ensure that our grassroots, people at the grassroots, get all the benefits in the form of DBT, in the form of whatever other mechanisms that all good technologies provide today, and disrupt the legacy processes, come out with newer ideas, come out with path-breaking ideas, and go right to the grassroots to get basics, infrastructure, drinking water, water for irrigation, power. There are still 70 years after independence, there are still thousands of villages in India which are languishing without power. On the one hand, we say that India as a country is power surplus, but there are still thousands of villages which do not have power. So unless this radical change is brought about by disrupting, because we talk about startups every single day, we talk about disruption every single day, we have to have disruption in governance, we have to have disruption in the way we work, we have to also have disruption in the way we function on a day-to-day basis as a government. Only then, once upon a time, Rajiv Gandhi famously said, ₹1 starting in Delhi, by the time it goes to a common man in a village, it's only 15 paisa or 12 paisa. That has to change. Unless that changes, this whole hope, this whole theme of hope I talked about is not going to come about very, very quickly.
Thank you, yes. Oh, we have lots of questions.
All of them are to Alia, I'm pretty sure.
Right, the front row, thank you. The lady in pink first.
Thank you so much, Karan. Hi. I'm Deeksha, I'm a global shaper from Dehradun, and I'm also a Teach for India fellow. My question is for Alia Bhatt. Like you mentioned that it gets too overwhelming at times, being a 24-year-old and getting so many opportunities, I relate to it. I'm 22, so it happens with me as well. And especially with the internet rolling out so many opportunities. I just want to ask, does detachment from your work help you in making better decisions?
I don't know about better decisions because actually I'm very emotional and passionate about my work as well. But I'll tell you something. There was up until a particular time I was constantly scared, and that was the time before I had failed. I've had done 10 films, and usme se one has been not a good film, and it did not do well. Until that time, I was always really scared, very passionate, very obsessive. The minute that happened, it's like my father told me, I became a mortal again. So when you touch success, you feel like you're immortal all of a sudden. And that could happen to anybody, which is why people are constantly telling me, please, keep your head on your shoulders, don't fly too high. And I was like, what are they saying? Why are they saying this? And then I realized that, okay, things can change, your films cannot do well, you cannot do well. And suddenly everything changed after that, and I was just brought back to ground zero. And everything after that is not, I would not say detached, like I'm not passionate about my work, and I don't feel like if today if I don't have a good day at work, I'll come back home and I will be stressed out about it. I won't be happy, and I'll give 200% the next day. But I can say I'm quite objective of the work that I do. And I go with my gut and I try to play around. So if I overthink my steps, then it's like, you're taking yourself too seriously, and that'll show on screen. Okay, she thinks she's a very good actor. But the minute I really, really believe in my part and my character, that just gives me that kind of ease to play with it and just, have fun with it.
Thank you, Alia. Yes, hello.
My question, my name is Roshan Raikar, and I'm a global shaper too. My question is to Mr. Rao and Mittal both together. Mr. Rao, what I feel is the government is doing a lot of, there are a lot of policies and then facilities for the people, but the people are still not, you know, it's not reaching the people. And people feel that our voice is not reaching the government. And Mr. Mittal has the platform. So is there a possibility of a collaboration so that, you know, if I have a question, I quickly, you know, post it and then we quickly get a response. So the communication gap, if it is reduced, I think there will be a great impact which we can bring. So can there be a possibility?
What's your name, sir?
Roshan Riker.
Roshan. Thank you, Roshan. It's a great question. How technology can be a great bridge between people and the government. In fact, India is the world's largest democracy, as you know. But there is absolute reality in what you said. There's a huge disconnect between the people and the government. In fact, a lot of times, because I have a lot of friends who are outside of politics, who are outside of government, so they give me some honest and brutal feedback. The general perception among people is that, you know, government mane koi aur cheez hai. Matlab, this is something that I have nothing to do with. A lot of times, this is more so in the educated, you know, urban elite and urban middle class as well, where they believe that, you know, they have nothing to do with the government. I'm a firm believer, before I come to your question, I'm a firm believer in one theory. I've read this saying in JNU once sometime back in Delhi. It read, when politics decides your future, you decide what your future politics is. Point I'm trying to make is, aaj democracy mein har wo cheez aap istemal karte ho, uska politics se direct link hai, vaasta hai. Aaj subah jab uthte ho, to brush jo use karte ho, paste jo use karte ho, jab sote ho, to jo takiya use karte ho, har cheez ka politics se ek direct link hai. Agar aap aloof rahoge, dur rahoge, bologe mujhe kya lena dena hai, aur ye politician log sab chor hai, aise hai, waise hai, agar aapko aisa lagta hai, then make a better choice. That is the one thing I would say, and that disconnect should go away eventually if we really have to grow and, you know, strengthen ourselves as a country. Now, coming to the point of how technology can be a great bridge between government and people, I think we are constantly doing it. In fact, many politicians that I know, many ministers, many MLAs, many MPs, are constantly on social media getting their feedback. We've also put up, you know, even if it is for the sake of optics, we all have put up dashboards on how we are working, in fact, as a government. Some governments are obviously more progressive, more dynamic when it comes to leveraging technology, some are not. But I'm sure there is a way where we can leverage tools like Hike, WhatsApp. In fact, sorry to say this, Kavin, but I use WhatsApp quite aggressively and extensively. In all my work, I have multiple responsibilities, and Karan said, how do you do it? I do it by way of technology. I have groups for each and every one of my flagship projects. I keep nudging my offices. I keep nudging my people, saying, guys, you have to get it right. Even as I sit here and as I speak to you, my phone, I'm sure, is loading all the updated pictures of what all has happened in different projects today. So technology is a great bridge. Technology is a great leveler. But I think that most important element of transparency, unless that comes in, people will not be satisfied. And that disillusionment and disconnect with people, between the people and the government, unless that goes away, there won't be a complete closure.
Kavin, you want to add to that?
I echo everything, you know, that's been said. And I think that technology is the one thing that can close the gaps of distance and the kinds of people. And I'm glad you asked the question, because we're actually building something on Hike where we can channel the voice of the youth in a way it can be packaged to become actionable. If you have a billion people in this country, voices can get lost. How do you change that? And how do you make it? And this is where big data, for example, comes in. How do you take all these voices and package it in a way where it's useful to government, industries, and so on and so forth? So watch this space. Within 6 months, you'll see something from us.
Great. Hi.
My name is Sneh. I'm from Ahmedabad. I'm also a global shaper. Alia, my question would be to you. We love you for the work that you do in Udta, Punjab, and Highway. And we also love the work that you are doing in Badrinath. So please keep doing different kinds of works. I work for Women's Health. And I want to ask this question where, you know, at a certain age, you are in the peak of your career. And you get opportunities and offers to endorse brands and stuff like that. What we have seen in past that, especially the female actors who are in the industry, they cross some stage and then they start endorsing the social causes and the brands. Do you get such offers to, let's say, endorse brands like which are socially connected, which are, let's say, women's health or, let's say, sanitation and so on? Or I know, I mean, we see you endorsing different brands, and obviously they are for the young generation. But the kind of work that I do, that female ask questions online to the doctors and counselors, and that is the brand. And I would like to, you know, aspire for you to have a brand ambassador one day to my brand. So, do you get such offers? And do you do your
endorsement right now?
That was more an offer than a question, but anyway. Will you endorse his brand?
No, at this age, at the peak of your career, and do you get such offers? And will
for
you
what? Social?
Social causes.
Social
like
causes.
Women's health is still unfortunately looked upon as a social cause.
Yeah, but it should not be. It's not a cause. It's health. So, no. I don't think an age... I mean, of course, yes, the brands that I do have to have, or at least for me, they have to, like... be an extension of my personality or an extension of maybe what I represent. But I'm not somebody who feels that women's health or even saying the word sanitary napkin is a taboo. I don't feel that way. And for me, a social cause, in fact, should not be an endorsement. In fact, I have started an initiative called Coexist, which is, you know, to do with animals and planet and about man and animals, and man and animals should coexist in our current, you know, environment and ecosystem. So I will, in fact, at any age, try to take up a cause that is very, very close to my heart. And if you want to offer me an endorsement, my manager is sitting right there. I can give you her number.
Yes, sir. Do you have the mic?
Hi, I'm Carlos. I grew up in Bombay, live in Singapore. You know, you mentioned that hope is the one word that describes India. And as far as 20, 25, 30 years ago, hope was the one word that described India. Do you think that India will ever realize, or when do you think India will realize this vast untapped potential that we are all so hopeful to see?
What's your name, sir?
Carlos. Carlos.
Carlos?
Yeah.
Thank you, Carlos. You moved from Bombay to Singapore, is it?
Yeah, YGL, if I didn't introduce myself completely.
Well, I'm not going to say India is going to become another Singapore for sure, but I would definitely give you this hope, you know, for a number of reasons. Yes, one, yes, India has always been a story, like I said, which has been looked at with a great deal of optimism and hope, even since the time I was growing up 25, 30 years ago also. Yes, you're right. But now I think a lot of things have come and are falling in the right place. Like I said, you know, all the ingredients are in place. You have governments which understand. You have politicians who are definitely more well-traveled, well-learned, and who are looking to really make an impact and who are really looking to achieve this potential. The last thing I would say, I think Indians, India as a country and Indians as a nation, we are also, you know, fully cynical when it comes to talking about our potential or how well we are doing. I think let's also start focusing on how, you know, well we've done some things. You know, we've sent MOM, Mars Orbiter Mission, which was completely made in India. So there are some good things happening. Don't undermine them. I would say, while it might take some time for us to become a Singapore or the United States, I do believe very, very strongly that this country, in spite of all its so-called failings, in spite of its drawbacks, limitations, in spite of its politicians, has done very well for itself. We should continue to strive. And I do believe, like I said, if we have the right kind of people working at it, chipping away, I think in the next 10, 15 years, we should join the league of at least the second world, if not the first world.
Great. We have time for one last question, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, there's a lady right in the center.
Hi, this is Anu Acharya from Map My Genome. So Karan, this is something you said in the morning. And you mentioned that we are at the interval stage and we are a melodramatic country and that there will be a happy ending. So my question to you is, when did we start? Because if you're in the interval, when will the happy ending come? And what happens thereafter?
Well, I would know the second half of most of the films that I make, but the second half of this country is truly that, and I take a leaf out of what Ram said, is full of hope. And I know for a fact the second half. We're at interval, which is a good thing, I think, because this is the point that you take stock of yourself. That's what happens at the midpoint of your life, or of a film, or definitely of your country. And I know that the second half is always meant to be the part where films escalate. And that's the hope I have for my country, that things will escalate. And of course,
the way our films end, which is invariably a happy ending. That's also my hope and aspiration for the future of this country's economy, political stability, and social happiness. So when is really a daunting question to ask anyone, because no one's a soothsayer here. Definitely no one's prophetic enough. So I don't want to be Nostradamus and tell you when, but the hope is that soon. So I will replace hope with the word soon, very soon, in fact. Thank you so much. This has been a really exciting discussion. We've touched upon various things, I think, from the hope that this country has to your individual challenges, all of you, Ram, and all of you, Ram, Alia, and Kavin, achieving at this young age, and so much to achieve and so much to look forward to in the zone of politics, entertainment, technology, and entrepreneurship. I mean, there is really so much that has been achieved, and there's so much to really go. And I think each one of you in your individual capacities are leaders. And I'm very proud, actually, to have moderated this session, because truly this session resonates the hope, the word of the day, for the future, for the moment, and for everything that's to come. So thank you very much. Any last thoughts anyone has, please feel free to voice them before we hold it against you.
Well, I think just to sum it up quickly, because it has been a great experience. I never thought I would be on the same platform as Karan Johar and Alia Bhatt. In fact, they just could not get Rahul Gandhi, so they figured they needed some political person, I think, and I was a space filler here. But thank you very much for this opportunity. I do know for a fact that India is doing very well on a lot of fronts, and India has been consistently proving itself on the world map as well. And with a very progressive prime minister, with states also really competing with each other, I think the day is not far when India can certainly, surpass that hope stage to the soon, to the very soon, to the fulfilling the potential stage. And I do hope we, again the word hope, I do hope we become less cynical as a nation. I do hope we connect more with the government. I do hope we stay more in touch with the realities of India. And I do hope, again, with that our Indians and as a country, our fellow countrymen exercise franchise and exercise, their judgment in choosing good leaders and right leaders. I think that should carry us through.
Thank you, Ram. Lalia, you have last thoughts on this evening?
I'm just really glad I made no faux pas and that I'm and that I actually got to learn a lot from Sir and Kavin today. It's been a really interesting experience, and I can go back to my friends and boast about all the intelligent things I've heard on this platform.
All right, Kavin, you have the last word.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Karan. I think it's been fantastic, and I think there was a question that was asked about the word hope and how it's been a theme that's been going for the last 20 or 30 years. I think two things. One is it's very, very important to slightly adjust the time frame in which we look at progress. This planet is 4.5 billion years old. We're talking about the last 30 years. Right. So that's nothing in the bigger sort of scheme of things. And people always tend to overestimate what happens in the short term and underestimate how much can happen in the long term.
Right.
And I think if we remember that and we keep making bold moves, I think we'll be fine.
Great. Yeah. Thank you. And on that note, we come to a close. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You've been a wonderful audience. And I'd like to thank the panelists again. Thank you very much.